Did you know there was a recent study, actually a sub-study of the Traverse trial, that showed that men on testosterone replacement therapy may be at greater risk of bone fracture? What's going on here? This makes no sense at all. We're going to unwrap this with Dr. George Fliatos after this, so keep watching. So a recent study, part of the big Traverse study, so the Traverse study, they name these studies with these long, weird, strange names to grab attention. They seem like they're from these high-level institutions, and was published in the New England Journal of Medicine. The Traverse study looked at 5,000 patients who were undergoing testosterone replacement therapy, and the large study actually had very positive things to say about men and cardiovascular issues who are on testosterone replacement therapy, essentially saying that men who are on TRT are not at any greater risk of having cardiovascular disease than those in the placebo, that is, those men who didn't have testosterone replacement therapy. So in the subset of the study, they looked at these men who actually showed a slightly higher level of bone fracture. Now, we've always come to believe that testosterone replacement strengthens the muscles, strengthens the bone. It does so by the conversion of testosterone to estradiol. So why would it be in this subset of the population that they had higher bone fracture? Well, we're going to unpick this right now. So what you have to be aware of in this study was, as most of these studies, the entry point for joining the study, you had to have testosterone levels as low as 10 nanomolars per liter. So that's around 300 nanograms per deciliter to enter the study. And the men in the study were from the age of 45 to 80. So he had quite a broad range. So again, this was also the same people in the study for the cardiovascular symptoms. What they used in the study as the treatment of choice, it wasn't injections, it wasn't libido injections, it wasn't the naphthenate or the cypionate, it was actually testosterone gel, and not just any old testosterone gel, not the androgel that's 5%, no, it was the 1.62% testosterone gel. That's nothing. You may as well put on a placebo. So they were very strict with the study as well. They looked at the men and said, if your levels aren't between 350 and 750, and if they went over that, they were dropped from the study. So my thoughts are, and we'll talk to Dr. George about this in a minute, are, well, hang on a minute, you underdosed the patients. You can't expect, and it did run for 3 years, the study, though. It did run for 3 years. You can't expect a low dose of testosterone to give you an adequate amount of estradiol to help protect the bone health. So I say shame on you, you researchers, for promoting such a bogus study. It's essentially a stitch-up, as they say in the UK. They put this thing together to make it look like it was legitimate, and at the end of the day, all they're doing is knocking the benefits of testosterone in this particular area, or drawing the wrong conclusion. So, George, what are your thoughts? Because this makes us mad as hell, doesn't it, knowing that the medical establishment, once again, are trying to find a way to demonize testosterone, and they scratch their heads saying, oh, well, I guess this is now a fact, and that testosterone may do something to the bones.
Even though, listen, the major factor concerning prostate and heart. But speaking about the bone marrow density, testosterone improves in two ways. First of all, you said it strengthens the muscles that are attached to the bones. The bones, as a result, become denser as a mechanism. Second of all, it improves the calcium reabsorption and the osteoblastic activity. Osteoblasts are the premature stem cells that will form later the bone tissue. And as you pointed out really well, estradiol is something that matures the bones. That's why postmenopausal women that lack of estradiol have more fragility. Now, Morgitrale spoke about the study and said there was not enough time to establish the bone mineral density. It takes more time. And of course, 750, it's okay, it's not bad, but you can have 950 or 1,000 nanograms that will give a better bone mineral density in the long run. Yes, they were underdosed, and 1.6% is a little bit of what women use as an HRT. Yeah. So personally, I'm using 20%, okay? But this is totally paradox to the common belief that androgens, we know that the cadurablo, for instance, improves bone mineral density, it's given to fractures. Androgens improves the bone mineral density and they heal the bone.
Well, one of the other things to consider in the study that it was about a 1% difference between the group that received testosterone and the placebo group, in the testosterone group, the group that had the bone fracture, there's only a 1% difference. 1% difference. So
close, huh?
For those who had the more fractured bones.
And you have to know that the person that is sedentary and doesn't train at all with resistance training doesn't improve the BMD.
Well, they did.
Needs to lift a little.
Yeah, but they
not just walking.
And they also pulled out the people that
were. Muscle has to do with D3 and calcium levels, because Calcium is absorbed only in the presence of D3, and we know that inadequate D3 levels are very common. You know, it's just about the sunshine or the eating the cheese, all right? It's about supplementing yourself.
Yeah, exactly, because even in sunshine, places like Greece, I'm sure you've seen as a biopathologist, patients' levels that are quite low.
Of course, more than 50% have below 50.
Even here in sunny Greece. Yeah. So that's something to note. One other thing on the study was the areas of fractures were the ribs, were the wrists, and the ankles. So why do you think that may...
Now, the ribs, come on, you don't have commonly, if you fall, I mean, the most common are the long bones, the tibia, yeah, and the femur also, but also the radius and the ulna. If in the study are elderly people that are more osteoporotic, perhaps they are chosen on purpose.
Perhaps, or the fact that they were so low. I mean, 10 nanomoles per liter, it's quite a low level of testosterone, and if they were low all their life or for a very long time until they got onto the study and were given
to reach 50% level,
and 3 years may not be enough to help overcome osteoporosis in this group. Yeah. So shame on you, New England Journal of Medicine, for publishing this rubbish.
I mean, it's not something that blows away testosterone. It's just about the bones, but the major concern and hesitation is about the heart and the prostate.
So on that side, and again,
this is a silly study and a silly topic.
Yeah, well, it was a small subset of that Traverse study that showed the cardiovascular bits. But you know, even in the Traverse study, when they showed that testosterone was safe for cardiovascular events, Dr. Stephen Nissen, he's from the Cleveland Clinic, was really quick to point out this, we should have caution. I guess this is the typical boilerplate language of the medical community in these things, is no one really wants to stand behind the benefits of testosterone. So they always mention, have caution when it comes to this, because I think they just don't know, or they just don't care.
That the major concern and hesitation about the cardiovascular issues is the clotting and the viscosity. And then I gave you the example, how many people are living in Mexico, in Colorado, in Nairobi, in Kenya, in Tibet. They all have erythrocytosis. Are they getting phlebotomized on a regular basis, or just a compensating mechanism? And as I was reading her doc's book again, he said that testosterone induces fibrinolysis, meaning that it breaks down thrombus. This obviously debunks the myth that it makes clotting tendency and more viscous blood, okay?
So it's a complicated story. There are lots of different moving parts and moving factors.
Chrisley said it all has to do with the platelets number. As soon as it's below 200,000, there's less frequency of clotting because platelets are the thrombocytes.
So yeah, I mean, testosterone can raise your hematocrit and hemoglobin. I think it depends on the individual, it depends on the person.
Not only the dose, sleep apnea, the high altitude.
And sometimes the dose, where...
The red misconception.
NAC, that's another one that I've recently discovered. If you add NAC, you may be at risk of having higher levels of either hypoxia in the vessels causing an increase in hemoglobin and hematocrit. I know personally for me, I went from a perfect number of 170 hemoglobin all the way up to 194 in a matter of 7 days. And the only difference was I was using NAC. So I think that's something that should be looked into even further. But getting back on the bone loss, you're right. It's a stupid subset of the data. It made news recently in some of the medical journals. And I think we've done a nice job in dispelling some of the myths. So if you're on testosterone replacement therapy, I don't think you have to worry about bone fracture if you're being treated properly and not with a 1.62% gel.
Bone fracture should be aware. I mean, it's something for women, that deals for women, okay? Because they become osteoporotic after the 50s and they receive HRT to improve this. But a man, seriously? Yeah. There's no tendency of bone fracture unless he's 80 years old and he's on a wheelchair.
Or has a suboptimal level of estradiol because the testosterone levels are too low in the first place.
Yes.
So look, if you're a man that you're on TRT and you obviously suffered bone fracture because of osteoporosis, let us know in the comments. I don't think we'll get many people like that.
You shouldn't abuse aromatase inhibitors. Use them wisely, occasionally, and don't crash the E2 for the sake of drier look. Because here it's not about the look and the bodybuilding, but about health.
No,
bone health and joint health depends on estradiol.
And in the study, they didn't use an aromatase inhibitor. It was just testosterone gel. Yeah, so I suppose that's not even part of the factor. But you're right. Large doses of AI shutting down your estradiol will not help your bone health at all. But yeah, thanks again, George. We had a great conversation. For those who like the content that we have on the channel, really do subscribe. It helps the algorithm, helps us make more content like this. Do leave your comments. Let us know what you think. We try to answer those. And until next time, stay healthy, stay safe, and we'll see you soon. We've barely scratched the surface today. For more insight into hormonal health, why not explore our channel? We've got a wealth of content awaiting your attention, and you can also visit our website at balancemyhormones.co.uk. So, this is Mike from Balance My Hormones, your beacon in the fascinating world of hormonal health. Until next time, remember, knowledge is power, and your journey to wellness starts here with Balance My Hormones.